Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Eric Green, director of the National Human Genome Research Institute, and I am delighted to introduce this new series called Journeys in Human Genetics and Genomics, which is organized in the form of a colloquium. And the background for this is really worth setting, not only for this first speaker, but just going forward. We at NHGRI have a number of major collaborations with the American Society of Human Genetics, one of which is a tradition of having fellows be part of training programs that are jointly organized by our institute and the American Society of Human Genetics. We've recently expanded that fellowship program into a larger umbrella program called the ASHG NHGRI Genomics and Public Service Fellowship Program. And as part of that, we decided to also add a colloquium series, this series, which is being nominally organized jointly between me as the NHGRI director and the president of the American Society of Human Genetics, who this year is Bruce Gelb, and that will change each year. And the idea is to have a two-year series, so over with a two-year cycle, not quite weekly, maybe about two or so a month, or maybe occasionally a third one in a month. And it directly is organized for the set of fellows that we have as part of this new umbrella fellowship program. But at the same time, we wanted to also take advantage of the fact that NHGRI has a lot of our own fellows and trainees within our intramural training program who will be listening in as well. And I think also very important is we're gonna always hit the record button. And we are then gonna take these lectures, which have been very carefully selected to try to capture all of the exciting things happening in genetics and genomics in a very accessible form, and then make that all available as recordings and as PowerPoint materials and PDFs and so forth available on YouTube for the videos and all the other materials. We will have a website that'll be freely available to anybody around the world in perpetuity. And so in doing so, we will collect a set of stellar lectures that people could be able to access and learn fundamentals in genetics and genomics told in a very accessible way. In other words, these are not research talks. These are supposed to be explanatory lectures on topical areas and have that available as an education outreach collaboration between NHGRI and ASHG. So that is the background to the series. It's all new. I'm sure we'll tweak it as we go along, but we think this is a great opportunity to provide some teaching and outreach material for various reasons that I've just outlined to you. So I'm gonna just turn the program over to the first speaker in the series, who is Larry Brody, a longtime member of NHGRI. He's gonna introduce himself and say a few things about himself and talking about DNA science and human genetics. And I will actually be back 1 week from now where I'm gonna be giving a talk on the history of genomics and the Human Genome Project. So Larry, take it away.
Thanks, Eric, and thanks for all of you in the room and all of you joining virtually. Just as an announcement, there are a couple of sections in this talk where there'll be active Q&A. You'll see the slide, so that's when you can ask questions. Feel free. You'll have two goes at it and a third go at the end. So thank you for joining for this a little bit of an experiment. This talk is going to be slightly different from the ones in the rest of the colloquium because I'm going to try to set the scene and create a framework for you to tie in to the big picture a lot of the other talks, which are going to be more focused. As by way of introductions, all the talks are going to include three sections, we hope. This one today certainly is. The first would be a discussion or at least some explanation of my journey. We hope all the speakers do the same of how we got to science. The second is kind of a landscape, what's going on in the field of the topic that you'll hear about. And the third, I mark the future, but it's supposed to be what's very hot right now. So expect this format to be followed through the rest of the series. And as I said, there'll be punctuation points for discussion and Q&A, which, as you just heard, will also be recorded. So questions can be really helpful for those listening to it later. So I would encourage you to vigorously ask questions. Some of the material we'll cover will definitely be new to you, and some of it will be, oh yeah, I already know that. And that's the idea, is to bring people to the same level. I am always happy to hear something I already know, so I know that you will be too, and then hopefully you will learn something. I don't normally talk a lot, so this is a lot of talking. I'm giving essentially three mini talks, and so I will stop, get water periodically to clear my throat. And also don't usually talk about myself, but I was very, very conveniently, a bunch of college roommates and I got together a couple weeks ago, and college roommates were 40 plus years ago, and that they apparently collected a bunch of pictures. So I'll start with my journey from a long time ago. But before I do that, I just want to start with a few examples of why I'm a little bit jealous of all of you. Because of the timing of you going into science. I chose genetics a long, long time ago just because I'm a nerd and I liked it. We combined a little bit of math, a little bit of biology, a little bit of evolution, but it was really not an explosive field back then. My timing was fine because it's become explosive, but just to give you a hint, I just looked at the news the last couple of days. Yes, last week, there was a lot of coverage on the paper appearing in Nature on maybe cracking the code for lupus, and I'll tell you why I think that might be a little bit exaggerated, but if you look at the tools that were used in this paper, and the highlighting here is mine, I don't know if you can, there's a little bit of a lag on the pointer. See, they used CRISPR, so you'll hear a lot about that. They used transcriptomic, epigenetic and functional screens. So all these tools you'll hear more about in the series. And this was to tackle a very, very difficult problem that's been unsolved for a long time. One caveat, if you dig deeply into this paper, you'll realize they only studied 17 patients and 17 controls. And so a theme I'll come back to later is how, as students, you should be really take a careful look at what people are studying and how they studied them. I did a quick analysis that the age of the controls was different from the age of the patients, and that might be a bit of a problem, but your job is to learn how to be critical thinkers too. The 15th, just a couple of days ago, new discovery to find a cure for pancreatic cancer. These are both, so it didn't come up. Are you seeing the pancreatic cancer thing on the? Mm-hmm. Well, so 2 days ago, there was a newspaper article. I see it, but they don't see it. No, it's not changing. On pancreatic cancer, another really intractable problem that genomic tools are starting to shed light into the difficulty. Okay, so we're gonna try again. Many of you have heard about the use of genomic tools to understand our evolutionary history. So that some of the work was actually originally done here at NHGRI in collaboration with folks in Germany. You also have seen articles about using genetics and genomics for things. Oh, still not coming up. Oh, there, it's just a lag. Okay, I'll just go with the lag, I'll go. For traits that maybe are less critical medically, and that just shows you the ubiquity of these tools. Another example is, I think most of you know that cold cases have been revolutionized by using genetic and genealogical techniques to find people who might have perpetrated these crimes even decades after they were done. And you'll hear a talk later in this series from a friend of mine who has played a hand in the early days of forensic genetics. I've put this flag below this picture. You'll see this occasionally when topics that I'm talking about actually have ethical, legal, and social implications. And I think most of you probably know that our institute has a program in investigating the ethical, legal, and social implications of genomic science and genetic science. And that's been the division that I head, and it's headed out of this building as well. You'll have a talk later that will cover the span of ethical, legal, and social implications of genomics. And that's been from the beginning of the Genome Project. Oops. Boy, it's really slow. Okay, I'm gonna I'm not sure why it's not coming up, but I'm going to skip the slide. Just go. There it goes. It's just slow. Okay. One of the things that I'm going to launch into my journey with is a study from just last week as well, using genomic tools to understand crop improvement. And genetics has been really pioneered in the agricultural sector, and then the human genetics sector created a lot of tools that are now going back into the agricultural sector. I bring this up because I went to a land grant college, actually worked in an agricultural department for some that you'll hear about in a second. So here's my journey. This is a photo taken from one of my favorite trails in north central Pennsylvania. It's called the Black Forest Trail, which I've done a couple of times, once or twice alone. And if you look carefully at this photo, you could kind of see the trail, but the trail is not really totally obvious. For those of you that are in the West Coast trails, you can see them from a mile away. This is a typical Pennsylvania trail. If you're really astute, you will see there's a blaze that marks a tree there that says where the trail is. And so that's kind of a paradigm for my journey. Wanted to be out there. Every once in a while, I would see marks that said, I should go here. But don't despair if you don't see those marks yet in your career, because sometimes you don't have them and sometimes you don't know where to look for them. And that's in part what we're here to help as well. So a land grant school I went to was Penn State University. As I said, embarrassing pictures are not on the web of me because the web didn't exist when I was in school. So I'll just show you a few that my roommates dug up. This is me in the dorm, not necessarily my dorm room because I didn't have bunk beds. Early on, and this was the first year that a telephone was actually installed in each dorm room. The year before, there was a payphone, which most of you have probably never used, down the hall. I also discovered that I really enjoy winter camping and winter sports during university. So I did a lot of cross-country skiing and winter camping, another picture from back way back when. But I also was very lucky in that I had, a work-study grant as part of my financial aid package. As soon as that fade happens, you will see an electron microscope. This is maybe it won't happen. Should I try a different mode? Because it's really slow. This picture that would come up is a Philips 300 electron microscope. And when you have a work study package, you could have a choice of either working in a lab or doing something. Okay, you can get out of that. But I chose to work in the electron microscope lab and learned how to drive this machine, which at the time cost over $100,000, which is probably closer to almost $1 million in today's dollars. And got a taste of the precision that you do in science. Prior to that, I'd never really done much other than chemistry sets and high school science. They let me drive and paid me to drive a $100,000 machine, which you could mess up. Fortunately, I never messed it up. And took photographs that appeared in a publication, which I didn't get credit for, but my boss did. So that was the first inkling I really had about science. Talking about freshman, sophomore year of college, where I had no really, I knew I wanted to be involved in biology, and I liked biology and I liked wildlife, and I liked being outside, but didn't really understand what science as an enterprise was. The next step was I got introduced to a lab that worked on the genetics of trout and salmon and was able to do an independent study project. So this one wasn't for money, but for credit, because they needed people to chop up fish and put them in test tubes. And there was seven of us would sit at a long table like you're sitting at today and would take out different parts of the fish and put it in the test tube. And they would be tested genetically in a way I'll show you right now. But it was the second time where I got to see what science does and how it operates and get to talk to peers who were also in science, which is not something I had ever before at home. We did genotyping using a method that's shown here. You may think it's a fuzzy gel, but these are actually, it's a potato starch gel. This is before agarose, before acrylamide was well used. And you could look at enzyme activity and stain for it in the gel. And I'm not gonna try, well, here's the pointer. You can kind of see some hint that there's something going on right in that portion of the gel. It's also the first time I actually saw grown-ups doing science. I didn't think I was a grown-up at the time. Some of these stains were used a UV light to see them, and this lab had big floor-to-ceiling windows. There was no way to make it dark, so I saw grown-ups open up a cabinet in the lab, stick their whole body inside the cabinet to make it dark enough to read the gels that they would shine with the UV light. And it was really in this lab with the lab mentor, the person who ran this lab, who I thought was very old. I now know he was much younger than I am now, who seemed to really enjoy his job. He was also the genetics professor that I had as a lecturer. And I thought, if someone that old could still enjoy his job many, many years later, maybe this would be not a bad career. And that really was kind of a key moment for me. I can tell you, after 6 months of cutting up fish, I finally started understanding what we were doing in the lab. It would explain it, but it was really confusing. The title of this paper's got a lot of jargon in it. I know the jargon now. Some of you could read the title and know what it means, but I bet some of you are reading this title and don't even know what it means. The other cool thing is this first author here, who had just left the lab when I joined, went on to go work with Alan Wilson at Berkeley, a very famous scientist, and then went on to work in Leipzig at the institute that has done all of the ancient DNA work. And I called him out of the blue about a decade ago for some help on an exhibit we were doing with the Smithsonian, and he just gushed and was helpful, which is another hint that the scientific community can be very, very generous and very focused on answering questions and less focused on what they want to do. I graduated, knew I wanted to go on to school, but didn't know exactly where, when, and how. So I got a job in a plant pathology lab. This is the tie to the land grant and the crops, working on the genetics of mushrooms, which involved more genotyping. Genotyping is a theme that you'll hear through my career. Back then, all the mushrooms sold in all the supermarkets in all the countries were essentially two or three clones. So all identical twins sold all over the world, same clones, not the same species, the same clone, because these are propagated in tissue culture. And I was learning how to genotype them so we could just figure out how to make the mushroom crop more diverse. Now you go to the supermarket, you can see this species of mushroom in a bunch of different varieties and a lot more different mushrooms. Second lesson about research, this job was funded by a grant that did not get renewed. And there goes my job. Still wasn't sure what I was going to do. So for a short time, I made hoagies, for those of you that live in Philadelphia, subs for those of you that don't live in Philadelphia, for a living for a couple of months, which working in food service is something I've done off and on through my career. It's actually not a bad thing. It's not a bad experience, life experience. You go home smelling a little greasy after a while, but this stint led me to reinforce, yes, I wanted to go back to school and not make subs for a living. And ironically, I went to a lab that worked on vascular permeability and atherosclerosis. So it's a nice tie-in between the sandwiches and my next job. And this was a physiology lab where I learned more about integrated biology, which is something I hadn't thought about much being a geneticist. Geneticist is genetics, molecular biology, or in some ways the ultimate reductionist discipline. Physiology is the integrative discipline. And this research experience, which I did before until I went to graduate school, really helped me think about the whole organism. It also gave me experience working with rats and dissections, and even one time having to go to the slaughterhouse to pick up a cow aorta, which was quite memorable. Yeah. It started, the cow aorta walked into the slaughterhouse on its hoof. It's not something you get to see when you grow up in the city. So at this point, I was applying to graduate schools and was accepted into several and decided to go to the human genetics program at Johns Hopkins, just up the street. I decided to go there for a couple of different reasons. One, this person was the head of the program. She was quite persuasive. And this is Barbara Majone. She had refounded this program after it had been dormant for about a decade. And still, it's a T32 training program that is supported to this day. So for those of you that think about extramural things, sometimes training programs live beyond. Barbara passed away a year and a half ago or so. The number six here is because she was the sixth female full professor at Johns Hopkins University, which was founded in the late 1800s. And so she, to be a full professor at Hopkins at that point, you really had to be tenacious, and she really was. Barbara was part of the reason, but not the really the main reason. The main reason is that this program required that you took most of the first 2 years of medical school, which some of you may be saying, yay, and others you may be saying, no. And so I thought if I was gonna study human genetics, that learning the human organism might be a really important skill to have. And they've since tailored the program to be a little bit less. The program still exists today. Anyone wants to talk about it? Happy to talk to you one-on-one about human genetics graduate programs, because I've been in a couple. But that's why I went there. And which means you didn't start research until after your third year, because you were taking a lot of course words year one and two, and you taught in year three. They don't do that anymore. It's a more research-focused program now. But that's why I went to graduate school. That opened up a lot of doors. There were two Nobel Prize winners walking around the halls, and I worked with or interacted with two people who subsequently won the Nobel Prize there. And the level of inquiry and the level of critical comments on your research was really, really high there. It's something that you should not, when people are giving you critical feedback on your work, you should take it as comments that are constructive, not as an attack. And that was certainly the case. One of the most intimidating things you had to do was present your work in a room like this full of people, including two Nobel Prize winners, and defend your work. And they were very good at asking incisive questions. The other important thing was that I met this person on my right, my left, I guess it is in the picture. And so that was the woman down the hall who has worked in another lab, who is now the 339th full professor at Johns Hopkins. So that was a big outcome at school as well. I then went to the University of Michigan. So big decision is getting into the field in the first place. The rest of it starts to get to be somewhat of a pipeline, depending on which route you went. I did a postdoc with the University of Michigan with a guy named Francis Collins. You may have heard of him. And was then about to take a job, a faculty job, actually back at Hopkins, when Francis said, starting an institute, wasn't an institute then, would you be interested in coming? And NIH was just starting a tenure track program at that point. They didn't really have one until then. And so I came to what was then NCHDR in 1993. That's a long time ago. I've been here ever since. That's what I looked like in 1993. You can see the time changes things. And then this is me, and this will be me next week. Notice there's fish on that pizza. My lab actually works on zebrafish a little bit. So there's a recurring fish theme. I'm not sure that was intentional, but I will go to the Jackson lab next week to do some teaching in the short course that I took when I was a student in the Hopkins program. It's kind of the end of my journey. Happy to talk about it one-on-one with any of you at any time. That includes everyone who's hearing this remotely. Now I want to switch gears a bit and talk about the landscape of human genetics and DNA science. This is going to be an idiosyncratic view, and again, it's designed to let you think high level about the talks you're going to hear in the subsequent year. It's divided into a couple of different parts. There's questions as you're hearing a talk you should ask yourself. Is we talking about something that's inherited or not? That's not a judgment call. That's just you want to know whether you're talking about something that's inherited or not. Is what I'm looking at really statistically significant? And most importantly, because we've gotten very good on statistical significance at this point, is what's the effect size? And then are there covariates and confounders? So I'm gonna use a few examples to run through this section of the talk. Some of it will echo things that you'll hear and go much deeper in the coming weeks. First of all, I consider myself a geneticist. First, probably a genomicist, maybe a little bit, but still genetics is my passion. And that is the raw material of genetics is variation. And when I'm talking about variation, it's variation that's passed from generation to generation. Mostly that's DNA sequence variation. There are also a few examples of transgenerational epigenetics, but very, very few. A lot of epigenetics is used in a different way. Not inherited are somatic mutations, epigenetic marks on most DNA molecules, and chromatin, environmental exposures. I'm not downplaying those. You're going to hear about them. They're critically important. In fact, some of the most dramatic advances from genomics have been understanding the cancer and being able to treat cancer based on knowledge of somatic mutations. So keep that in mind, but you want to divide it. Sometimes people talk about a gene for this, a gene for that, and they're not talking about inherited anything. They're talking about what happens to the gene or how does it function. In fact, the examples I used with lupus and pancreatic cancer, none of those were about inherited. They were about using genomic tools, which you'll hear a lot about, to understand these phenotypes. Go back to where I started in the 70s, this starch gel. Fast forward to today, and I'm skipping over this whole timeline because you're going to hear a lot about the Human Genome Project next week. I'm just going to skip back to 2024. That's now. And where are we at? We have created an environment where almost everyone understands the power of DNA. Now, this is not Taylor Swift or Beyonce, but I think people probably know who this is. You may not know that she had a very important, to her, case about her DNA being extracted from, just say, an article of clothing that someone obtained without her permission. And she wasn't worried about the article of clothing, she was worried about her DNA. And a lot of what you have heard and a lot of what the public has heard is about the power of DNA. And so, not to paraphrase Marvel Comics, I think it's Marvel Comics too much, with great power comes great responsibility. And that's really where a lot of you come in, because you're going to be the people responsible for the next generation of geneticists. There's the little ethical, legal, and social implications flag. We can discuss this, or you'll have a talk on this. So why do we do this at the NIH? We don't do it because we're worried about Madonna's underwear, right? We do it because we want to move genetics into clinical practice if it can improve health. And this is in the realm sometimes called personalized medicine, more accurately probably called precision medicine. Precision medicine is a big umbrella. What's under that umbrella? It's diagnostics, pharmacogenetics, risk assessment, risk modification. Sometimes you might call it prevention. Understanding biology, so that leads to new drugs. And I actually took gene therapy off the slide for a couple of years because it was looking pretty dismal for a while. I'll come back to this at the end. It's not looking as dismal as it was 10 years ago. And so it's back on the slide because I thought maybe it's coming around again. But all of these things, genetics and genomics, can have an impact and are starting to now. So this is the why. This is what you're all involved in, to some degree. The new biology is a placeholder for all the basic science. So the basic science that is done really opens up realms for investigation going forward. I want to draw a distinction between genotyping and sequencing. Genotyping, and this distinction is probably less important now going forward, as you'll hear about sequencing technologies and how powerful they are and how easy they are. But previously, you would genotype, which just asks, see the pointer, what nucleotide is at this position, an A or a G? And there are methods to do that very cheaply, very efficiently. At NHGRI, and I help run a lab that does it, has done it for close to 1 million samples over the last 20 years. And that's a really powerful force. I'll talk to you a little bit about what we use it for, but more and more sequencing, which doesn't ask what's this nucleotide, it asks what are all of these nucleotides, and they could be anything. And as you'll see in subsequent talks, sequencing has become more and more powerful and more economical. So it eventually should take over from genotyping. I still have a fondness for genotyping. So if you look at this gel, there's a homozygote, there's a heterozygote, there's the other homozygote. See, even you can genotype without even using DNA. This is a picture of enzyme activity in a gel. When I started in the field, there were about 67 different loci you could score in the human genome. There were some chromosomal differences, but mainly there was that number of variants that were common enough to score if I genotyped you. 67 in humans that you could do with this method. Now, there's over 1 billion documented that you can look at. Those are common and rare ones. And that's because the genome is big. And as most of you know about every 1,000 bases or so, we differ. And so these are all cataloged, and it's actually should be no big deal to you. To me, it's still stunning that we have this number of variations. Cataloged, you'll hear a talk at some point on copy number variants. Those are bigger things. I'll just leave it at that because you'll get wading into more detail. This also, as a geneticist, makes us squirm a bit because the dogma was every cell has all the same genome and everyone has the same genome. There are just slight differences. Now, some of you have a million bases more than I do. And some of you have 2 million bases more than I do. And I have 2 million bases more than you. Some of the other, I still haven't wrapped my head around the fact that we could be that variable in big chunks of DNA. But we are, and they're documented, and they actually, some of them have implications for phenotypes, and some of them are benign. You'll hear more about that. I want to take you back to where you've heard about genetics first. I'm not going to do a poll, but if everyone in this room has heard about Mendel and genes, right? And you've also heard about fruit flies. By the time you leave this training program, you'll be much more sophisticated about genetics, but you should know that most of the general public last had genetics in high school, if at all, and they remember fruit flies and peas. And I'm gonna tell you why we have to change that going forward. Not that we're gonna do away with it. You also remember these because you had quizzes about what these are and you had to fill out a short answer to describe all of these things. Right? And they're all really important genetic terms. Are they important for your life? And they're important for the life of the general public? I'm not 100% certain. Ari Weinberg is one of my favorite all-time concepts. It's easy to write test questions on, but does the general public need to know about Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium? Why are we teaching it in high school? Not totally sure. And even worse, Punnett squares. I'm sure all of you have had quiz questions or test questions where you had to fill out Punnett square. The idea behind a Punnett square is just to understand segregation and assortment. It's really easy. Why we're making students learn more and more complicated Punnett squares, I don't totally understand. So one of the things that we hope to do in part through another part of my division is to start to reform the genetics curriculum so it's more relevant to real genetics. And when I say real genetics, I'm not downplaying this. This is a human pedigree. It's a dominant trait. I would normally quiz you and say, is this a dominant recessive, right? It's dominant because it's present in each generation. And there's a woman who wants to know something. And so for Mendelian genetics, we can help, right? So we can tell her something because for Mendelian genetics, the genotype approximates the phenotype. It's not perfect. There are lots of things, lots of variability, but Mendelian genetics can be very, very powerful for that reason. So in this case, we could tell this woman what her risk is of inheriting a dominant condition. Would normally quiz you, but I think it's a half. Right, so she comes into the clinic, you can say, what is the chance that I'm gonna get what my mom gets, inherit what my mom had that made her ill? We can tell her that because of Mendelian genetics, and that is fantastic, and we've made great progress. You're gonna hear about rare disease and Mendelian genetics in another talk. We made tremendous progress using all these modern tools to solve lots of Mendelian conditions. So that's Mendelian. The other 99.8% of all traits aren't Mendelian. So if you were to exclude disease, most of you could not name more than 4 or 5 at the most phenotypes in humans that are Mendelian. I'm not talking about disease, I'm just talking about general phenotypes. So look around the room, you're all different. You're not different because of Mendelian traits, right? You're different because there's genetic influence, but it's not Mendelian. And a lot of it is quantitative traits, and you will hear some talks on quantitative traits. And this is an example of how the early pioneers in quantitative genetics, and you'll hear probably in the talk in 2 weeks, a little bit of the division between quantitative geneticists and Mendelian geneticists. There were two camps. They both were right, and they had a little bit of an argument. But here's a quantitative phenotype. Pick a phenotype that you can measure and think about it. Can genetics explain something like that as opposed to Mendel's tall and short peas or green or yellow peas? The answer is it actually can, but the phenotypes have to be distributions. So if you look at this, this is one gene with two alleles, and allele, genotype, and locus are three concepts that you should always internalize before you leave here. So if you're not, if you're saying, oh, I'm a little bit confused about an allele and a locus, we need to get them all straight as you go through this program. The two flavors that this locus is a gene, it has two flavors, and that can produce three genotypes. Right? These would be the heterozygotes, these are the homozygotes, and these are the other homozygotes. And so here you have a variant that affects a quantitative trait, but it doesn't affect it precisely, it affects it and shifts it balance-wise. This is really important and actually very, very useful, because if you were to look at this, and let's say it's blood pressure, so that up at this end, blood pressure is too high, you can see that people with this genotype are more frequently going to have high blood pressure than people with this genotype. And that forms the basis for something that we do a lot of, association studies. And association studies are different from family-based studies, but they can produce and have us understand the genetic basis or the genetic underpinning of certain conditions. Why is this important for quantitative traits and complex traits? It's because they really underlie most disease. So here's an example of a quantitative trait, height, right? There's other quantitative traits going on, skin color, facial hair. I don't know if that's a quantitative trait, but you intuitively know that should we be able to cross these individuals, we would not see short, tall, because it's not an individual trait. So this example, one locus, two alleles, three genotypes. This example, how many genes do you think are involved? Anyone want to hazard a guess? No guesses? Here's a shot of it. So we'll call this a complex phenotype. So here's an example of height. Just like the histogram, or just like the Gaussian distribution, height is mostly a Gaussian distribution in the population. These are military recruits. From 1914. I'll come back to this in a second. This is how complex phenotypes look. And this is some of the complex phenotypes that essentially our medical system spends billions of dollars on every year. So there is a genetic component to all these complex phenotypes. They're not rare. I'm sure if you're reading this list, all of you have a family member that's been affected by something on this list, and the list is not exhaustive. So we really want to understand complex traits which are not Mendelian. How do we figure out if they have a genetic component? Classic way, which you probably won't hear that much about, but it's still useful, is to look at twins. Monozygotic twins, identical twins. Anyone a twin? No twins in the room? Share 100% of their DNA. Dizygotics share 50% of their genome. And so in theory, they share a similar environment. I'll come back to that in a second. But you can use the difference of concordance in the monozygotic to dizygotic twins to figure out how much genetics are involved. If you look at twin studies, you can see these complex conditions, the concordance, meaning how concordant they are, is greater in monozygotic, the ones that share all of their genes, compared to shows those that share only half of their genes. Notice the concordance is never 100%. This was Mendelian, it'd be 100%, but it's not, and that tells you other things are going on. This is a way to look at the entire genome without even opening a DNA molecule, because you're just looking at the natural experiment. From these kind of studies, we can reject things like Huntington's disease. It is a true dominant disorder. Almost everyone who has the bad allele or the flavor of the bad allele will get Huntington's disease. Cystic fibrosis is up there, cardiomyopathy in the middle, breast cancer, I'll explore this in a few minutes, as it's got a range. Type 2 diabetes has a strong genetic component. That doesn't mean that everyone who has type 2 diabetes has the genetic component. It doesn't mean people who have the genetic component gets type 2 diabetes. And things like Alzheimer's disease, which happened late in life, have a lower heritability, as we would call it. And that's probably because it's a product of the life experience as well. When you're hearing people talk about heritability, you should just remember that study design and sample ascertainment really matters. So remember, I just said, I'm not being critical of the Nature paper on lupus, but if you ascertain people who are young age for your cases and you are older age for your controls, is that a problem? You have to ask that question. You can adjust for it. You can make arrangements to control for that, but you have to ask about it. So there are a couple of different study designs I want you to think about. You'll hear about this in some of the other talks. Cross-sectional, often we ascertain people in clinic and then we try to figure out people who either in the hospital who don't have that disease or people in the population who don't have that disease to do a case control study. That's a very common study design. It's convenient because you can do it in your lifetime. Show you a study design that's harder to do in your lifetime. But you know that if I ascertain my controls at the farmer's market and my cases from the clinic, there might be other differences that I'm pulling in. Oh, and for those of you that are epidemiological trained, it's different language. Selection bias and ascertainment bias are the same thing. Geneticists call it ascertainment bias. Epidemiologists call it selection bias. So if I ascertain my controls from the farmer's market or the bar, I might get differences in my controls and it might look like my cases are different when actually my controls are different. So keep an eye open when you're looking at studies about that. The other study design, which is the one that takes longer, is longitudinal. You can imagine ascertaining people at this stage and then following them through to that stage. That's really a superb way to do studies. Unfortunately, it doesn't fit with the NIH funding cycle. It doesn't fit with careers, and we don't do enough of it. There are some longitudinal studies that have been going on at the NIH for 50 years in various places, and some like the Framingham Jackson Heart study are on their second generation of people are studying. So it can be done, it just takes dedication. And there, if you're trying to study the onset of disease and you start ascertaining here in the nursery, when no one has the disease, you get control for everything. But instead, we do epidemiologic studies, sometimes in the family base, but more often to get the numbers in this kind of case control setting here. That has led to the creation of association study called the genome-wide association study, which I'm going to guess most of you know about. Here's one we did on a plasma component. And you look at these, anything above this line is statistically significant. And if you look at this, this is the number of zeros after the p-value, roughly. So this is a 10 to the minus 84th p-value. You get excited about that, but it actually is absolutely meaningless. It just means that this association didn't happen by chance. And so as a critical reviewer of these studies, say, great, that association between that gene right there and this particular measurement is real. The next step is to say, how much does it matter to the trait? And so here we've scanned the entire genome looking for connection, non-random association between all of these SNPs. So 2.4 million SNPs imputed in the genome, and only two genes pop up out of all the genes we have. I can tell you that this one actually affects the phenotype a fair bit for a metabolic trait. It's 10-15%, which is a lot, but some of them affect the trait very, very small amount. I'll show you an example of that later. One of the things you have to think about is how do we communicate to that to someone where it's a common variant, it increases the risk of disease, but you don't know exactly how to communicate that it's just a tiny bit. So we did a study a long, long time ago where we tackle this, and here's examples of two ways we showed people information. You can take the minute to read it, but you can see some people like to see information this way. This is type 2 diabetes, 35 out of 100 who don't even have the genetic risk. In this case, it's a single gene. We'll get type 2 diabetes. You don't have the genetic risk. If you have two bad copies of this particular gene, of this allele, 43 out of 100 will get the risk. Some people like to have that information that way. Other people like to see pictures like this. So this is used to be an ELSI thing. It's now a clinical translational issue on risk communication. You will hear more about risk communication in this series. And it just shows you, you've got no genetic risk, here's your chance of diabetes. You have two bad copies, here's your risk of diabetes. If you have one, here's the intermediate, here's another one. Or skin cancer. Skin cancer is rare. Very few people get it. You have two versions. You quadruple your risk, but you're still unlikely to get skin cancer. These are what matters when you're translating these results, is what is the risk. To go back to this, these are individual genes. That's one gene at a time. What about the 21,999 other genes? I am not going to address how many genes we have in the genome. Ask Eric that next week. It's still unresolved, but I'm just going to round to say there's 200. There's 22,000 genes in the genome. That's technically 22,000, give or take a couple hundred protein coding genes. It doesn't account all the non-protein coding genes. But we've been doing what we've been talking about up until now is one gene at a time. We don't need to do that anymore. Go back to this height example. Height's a really easy trait to measure, right? And a really easy trait to measure objectively. Believe it or not, there are certain traits that you would think you'd measure objectively that people still fight about: blood pressure, whether someone has cancer, not has cancer, tumor size. Height we can measure. So it's been measured and genetically tested in over 2 million people at this time. And there's more than 700 genes, and there's 10,000 variants that account for 60% of the heritability. There's probably some other variants that account for the rest. Remember, height's only 30, 40% heritable, right? So if you look at this picture, we can genotype people, figure out where they would likely to be in the distribution, but we're going to have some uncertainty going back and forth. We'll come back to height in a few minutes, but I just want to use a quick example of work that I was involved in as a paradigm. And I used to give this talk on inherited breast cancer. It said, we now understand some of the genes involved in inherited breast cancer. You take all the cancers and all the phenotypes, we'll eventually understand them all. And now I don't say that anymore. And that's in part because what we now know, there are fewer genes of large effect than we thought for a lot of phenotypes. So the topography of cancer risk when it first started, it was kind of murky. We just didn't really know what we were looking at. And we couldn't quite see everything. But we now, after 25 years of going at this, we now understand the topography of risk. It's very, very clear. There are some big peaks of risk. There's some little peaks of risk. There are a lot of little peaks, little tiny peaks. Some things are common, some things aren't common. And I want to just give you a framework for thinking about that, because it'll be relevant to some of the other talks you hear about. And that's this particular framework that a friend of mine, Will Folks, published a long, long time ago in the New England Journal of Medicine. The fact that the more frequent the allele is, so the more frequent the variant is associated with disease, the less likely it is to be relative risk. So this is risk on this axis and allele frequency on this axis. And this actually comes true because if there were really frequent, high risk things, we would know about them right away and they would segregate in families, but we don't see that, right? We see cancer only occasionally segregating a family. We see blood pressure only occasionally segregating in a family. Mostly it's more sporadic out there in the randomness. And then there probably are very rare things that barely influence risk, but you need to get to height size samples, 2 million, 10 million to find them. And they're likely rare and don't influence risk that much. So they're not going to get a lot of attention. What we've been able to do with almost 30 years of work is kind of fill this in for inherited breast cancer. So we know there's some big players that very, very strongly increase your risk of breast cancer. There's some intermediate players, and then there's a lot of high frequency but low risk players. And that has helped people figure out how to estimate risk. It still gets, we thought there would be three or four more of these. There's not. There's only a couple of high risk players. For a lot of cancers, we've been unable to find any high risk players. So that's why I'm thinking it's more the exception. Same is true for a lot of other conditions. There's a few high risk players that account for a small number of cases. Important in those families, but not as important for the population. But really important in those families if you have something you can do about it. And that's what you'll hear a lot more about in other talks as well. Here's another way to look at it. These are the big players. This is cumulative risk. Lifetime risk approaches 70% for BRCA1 and 2. This one, a PALB2, goes up to 40%. Here's the population risk. Just if you're a woman, this is your risk of breast cancer if you're a woman. Here's a variant that just barely nudges that above. Would you have a mastectomy based on that data? Probably not. Even these are hard to figure out what you would do about. So this is the realm where understanding the biology could be really helpful, but maybe telling people that they have a 4% increase of risk might not be all that helpful. And so that's why I said understanding the magnitude of the effect is really important. You should always ask, okay, it's associated, but what's the magnitude of the effect? This is probably going to be, this paradigm is probably true for almost any condition you can think of. that will have common, for complex diseases, we'll have common variants that, drive it, and then we have a few Mendelian mutations. And the common ones are made up of a zillion different flavors. This is what it looks like if you take a sample size, almost 70,000 people. This is the distribution of risk alleles of the common ones in cases and controls. And what you can see, unlike those drawings I did earlier with a quantitative trait, these almost totally overlap. And so you have a woman that's got lots of risk alleles, in this case, 80 of them here, and a woman has very few. Do you tell them anything? What do you do about this parts of the distribution? There's almost complete overlap. So it's very hard to find utility in these as even just counting them in carrying them. So some people have really bad luck, they carry a lot, but the common ones don't shift the risk profile that much. There is one exception to this that you'll hear more about, and that's what we've learned in the last couple of years using a method borrowed from agriculture, which is not usually referred to, and that's called the polygenic risk score. You'll hear more about that in other talks, and we have explainers on our website. Turns out you can take a subset of those, and if you aggregate them using lots of computational work, you could aggregate them and show that they move the risk. If you carry that specific subset, they move the risk up potentially into the actionable area. So that's a new thing that's only years old at this point, that gets a lot of exploration to see if it's clinically useful. And we have programs at NHGRI working on that right now, and it's working, the people working on it all over the world. That's genetics. Going back to the height thing, this is the same state. It's Connecticut. It's not the same school, because the other one school I don't think exists anymore. Faculty in 1997 lined every up. What has changed? Well, there's two things. The school now admits women. They didn't in 1916. And so the people dressed in white are women. People dressed in black are men. So what has changed? I didn't point it out, but if you look at the mean height in the 1914 picture, the mean height for the guys in that picture was 5'7". I used to be 5'6". I just found out I shrunk a little bit. So is this the mean height for a guy? Not anymore, right? The mean height in this picture is 5'10" for guys. So what's changed from 1914 to 1997? It's not the genes. The genes didn't change. Genes, especially complex traits that involve 710,000 different variants, don't change frequency over that time, even in Connecticut. What has changed is the environment. And we have shifted the height of the population, this population, up. And it's because you can quantitate, it's almost a whole standard deviation higher. It may not sound like that, but in height, we have lots of data. So it's a few inches of a whole standard deviation. Didn't help me, and that's because there are other things going on. So I've tried to find the familial aggregation in truck choice. All I could find was the percent of families that rebuy the same brand of truck. So this is brand loyalty. The yellow one is a Ford truck, and the white one is a Chevy truck. And my brand loyalty has 62%. Heritability, I'm using air quotes because I didn't get the family data, and Chevys have 55% heritability. Is there anything genetic, do you think, about choosing a Ford versus a Chevy? I've never had a truck, so I can't comment, but I don't think it's probably not genetic. So what are we missing? I'm going to wind down here with what we're missing and what we need to think about, and that's the environment, right? So this is a tongue-in-cheek picture. I'm pretty sure no kids were harmed doing this. This is also from the archives. But that's because what we've been measuring is just gene. And really, the phenotype is the product of the genes, the environment, the genes interacting with the environment, and the genes interacting with each other. This is the simple version of this formula. I don't remember if you're going to have someone who's going to show you even more complicated versions. But this is kind of, if we're going to explain phenotype, we have to start filling in these terms. And that's one thing that the Institute is starting to fund research on, trying to help understand these interactions. And there's your ethical, legal, social implication flag. If we find out where you live is making you sick, what are we supposed to do? It's a return of results kind of issue. It's the same if we find out your genes are making you sick. So I'm just winding down complex phenotypes. Most of the phenotypes we see in the world are complex phenotypes. They involve multiple genes, they involve modifier genes. There are two terms that I'm happy to define for you, but variable expressivity means you can have the same version of it of an allele and it can express slightly differently. Variable penetrance means you can have the same version of the allele as someone else and that person gets sick and you don't. All these are features. There's a significant environmental component with exposure to the outside world, the built environment, that's what that's supposed to refer to. And as most of you know, the social environment is quite critical in health as well. We're moving to pausing right now for questions. And let me see time-wise, I'm a little bit behind, but go ahead, shoot questions. And then I have one more section on the future. And for those of you that are joining online, please just raise your hand and your turn on your camera and you'll pop up to the front of the online queue. Can I ask you to identify yourself for everyone? Because a lot of people, especially online people, don't know.
Well, hey, everybody in the room and hey, everybody online. My name is Cameron Washington. I'm the Education and Engagement Fellow. Also have a background as a genetic counselor. So some of these are coming into clinical questions. I wanted to go back, Dr. Brody, to when you talked about copy number variants in the genome. I knew that people had small extra missing pieces of genomic material, but I think that the way that you explained it, talking about like 20 million base pairs and sequences. So can you talk more about like what that genomic variation is from a large scale as opposed to sequence variants again for us?
Yeah, it's a whole family of things. And the dividing line between when you don't have one triplet repeat compared to another and what is a copy number variant, there's some strict definitions. I'm talking about stuff that's bigger than that. And it's not my area of research, but it's been a very active area of research by quite a number of people in the human genetics community. And so we tend to think of the genome as going from telomere to telomere and everyone's got the same nucleotides and the identity is the different, and maybe there's some short repeats that are different, but not that someone could have 1,000 bases missing in someone else. And I'm trying not to make a judgment call because we don't know if that's missing or just extra. Mm-hmm. But what research in this area have done is found that there are even some people who have 1 billion bases that especially weren't represented in our reference genome, which is why we're rebuilding a better version of the many reference genomes. We have a big program on that. And some of those are probably benign and some may influence disease risk, but it could be a chunk of 1,000 bases that someone has, someone else doesn't have. Quite often they're in repeated regions. So they may be a little bit more flexible and a little bit more benign. But a lot of it, we still don't know. Sometimes they are well tagged, which means if I look at a SNP here adjacent to them, I can measure their impact on the phenotype just by measuring a SNP nearby them. And sometimes they're totally missed because we didn't even know they existed because we only sequenced a handful of people. It's a pretty active area of research. It's distinct from the ultimate in copy number variant where you have an extra copy of a chromosome. You know, we know there's a couple of those that are compatible with full development. Most of them are not.
To contextualize it, the way that it's come up for me in clinic has been you have a child who has autism. We do a microarray on the child. They have some extra material. Then you go back and test mom and you go back and test dad. And one of them also has the extra material, but they're unaffected. They may come back and say, yeah, I had some anxiety as a kid or a learning disability, but you say that they're unaffected. The other way it comes up is people who have extra missing digits, for example. Again, the child has the extra missing digits, but you go back and the parent has that exact extra material, but doesn't have any signs or symptoms as well. So it's kind of interesting to link the way that you explained it back to how I've seen it.
And sometimes what you're finding is cause and effect. Sometimes it's true, but unrelated. And then if it is cause and effect, it's an example of, in one case of variable expressivity, the other case of variable penetrance, which are all known genetic things.
We have a question online from an anonymous participant saying, thanks for such an informative talk. Could you comment on some of the approaches we could use to incorporate environmental variables with genetics in predicting risk in clinical settings?
Okay. So thanks for the question. The It's not a direct answer, right? Because incorporating environmental variables, there is no one genetic study. And this is the one thing you'll see in the second part of the wind down of the talk, which I'll come to in a second, is that we have to keep thinking that genetics is monolithic. So in some cases, it's obvious what we should measure. And there are tools in something called the Phoenix, P-H-E-N-X toolkit, where there are tools that you can measure. There's a whole section on measuring social determinant variables. And you can measure some things that people say, oh, it's very hard. I can't measure this. It's complex. Turns out you can measure racism, you can measure living in bad neighborhoods by very simple measures, meaning asking people 7 or 8 questions. What we don't know yet, and what we have not been very good at, is tying them in to the analytical pipeline. And maybe that's what the question is about. We used to not be able to understand how to tie in RNA-seq data and SNP data. I remember people throwing up their hands, how are we going to combine all this? Now we can do it. So I think the analytical methods will catch up as long as we have the data collected. And there are standardized methods to collect lots of social determinants of health. And I'll talk about that in the last part of the talk. And for time-wise, keep asking, because the last part of my talk is shorter than on the guidelines.
And you've been talking about all these and new...
Introduce yourself.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I'm Jessie. I'm the post-bac program analyst here. With all these like new different technologies to assess risk and all of that, how accessible is it cost-wise to the general public if it's all kind of up and coming?
I think this will get to what I'm going to show you in a few minutes, in that it is not yet ready for us to say, let's sequence everybody and figure out this from then on. So right now, there are some things where it does make sense to use genetics. There's a lot of things that we're working on, and there's some things that we've not even crossed yet. So there's no one answer to that. For certain things where we've done, and what we are, I think, what you're kind of alluding at is translation. So how do we take the stuff that we understand at the basic science level to the clinical level, then to the practice level, and then get it out there so that the community hospitals and the community docs use it as well? That's a long trip, and it has to prove itself in all of those settings. And so our institute is doing work in all of those areas. There are very few now that there's this phrase called tier one conditions, meaning they've been done, taken all the way to the end where it improves health, makes economic sense to do, and should be translated. There are only a couple of those, inherited breast and ovarian cancer being one, inherited colon cancer being another, high cholesterol levels of a certain flavor is another one, and a couple of heart ailments that are more Mendelian that lead to a condition, either hypertrophic or hypoplastic hearts, where intervention is warranted. That's about it. So less than a handful of them have gotten all the way there. There's a ton, and I'll get into the next second, a ton that are in this pipeline. And we should be always open-minded. Some of these things that we want to do genetically that make sense in the lab, they make sense in the test clinic, make sense in the case control clinic, they might even make sense in the early clinical trial, may still not make any sense in the real world. And we have to test it against what we're doing now, not just get so enthusiastic that we have to inject genetics even if it doesn't help and just costs more money. So there's no one answer to your question because we're gonna have to work through it. And if we want adoption of these things, we're just gonna have to work through it. Okay.
So I'm Kristen Lewis. I am the director of the fellows program here at ASHG. And I was curious, for somebody who is not trained in genetics or genomics, the people outside this building, what is one thing you wish they knew about DNA, genetics, or genomics? What is the one big message you'd like everyone to know?
In the soundbite version, it's that quite often DNA, your DNA is not your destiny. It's the soundbite version.
What's the 2-minute version?
I'll get to that. So I what I'm going to touch on now, and we're going to then we'll have another question Q&A session, is the future. It's the charge to our speakers is to talk about the most exciting areas in your field. And I labeled it the future, but I also earlier just said the future. Now I'm saying the future is close. And I'll tell you why I'm saying that in this section. And I'm not the only person that says this. Steve Jobs, who some of you may know personally, I don't. He really did think that the next century we're in is going to be at the intersection of biology and technology. And that's why I started saying I'm pretty excited for you guys, because I really think we are about to explode, but we're not there yet. In both biology, not just genetics, but biology in general, and technology. And we're already seeing, and you'll hear a lot more about in this talk, how technology has led the way in genomics. That has led also to some things like this, right? This was a decade ago, I'm not sure. I did read the article, talked about things that could happen. And our communications fellow can probably confirm this. People who write articles don't get to write their headlines, so I'm not totally sure who wrote the headline. I'm not going to blame it on this guy. But this genomics and genomic technologies kind of fit what's known as the Gartner plot. And so take a second to look at this. This is a social science kind of bit of work that says when we have a new technology, you get all excited. There's a peak of inflated expectations. You can fill in whatever blank technology you want. And then because they're inflated, you come down here a little bit, and then you get the trough of disillusionment, and then you get realize, oh, maybe it is going to work. And then you get into where it really is starting to work. So the toilet flushing, sequencing your DNA for less than flushing your toilet. When I saw that headline, I looked up at how much it costs to flush your toilet. We are not going to be able to sequence the DNA unless my water bill goes way, way up, because I can flush the toilet a lot and still not be as much as flushing, as sequencing DNA. So that really goes there, that kind of. And I will say that because as geneticists and genomicists, we are so excited about this stuff, we did spend a little bit too much time in this part of it. And we did inflate expectations to a certain degree. And even Francis Collins a couple of weeks ago in an education thing said we may have started telling physicians they need to know this stuff a little bit too early. And I was in that camp for most of my career, is that we need to be able to do this before we tell people they should do it. And I do think we are actually now here, which is why I'm excited for you guys. You know, I'm winding down here. You're about to go into where this stuff really works. I think we've been through that trough. The technology is only getting better, and we're starting to figure out where it works. And so what I'm going to do is just pick a few things very quickly that I think I'd be pretty excited about if I was starting my career now. This is not inclusive. You're going to hear a lot of talks in this session from people who are also doing other things. I purposely did not, in the interest of time, did not list absolutely everything. And so you asked about proven programs, right? So this is idiosyncratic. There'll be people who will push back, especially when I say things aren't ready. But I think that newborn screening, which is something that we've been doing for, in some states, 50 years or longer, and that most of you, I'm looking around the room, and I don't know the people on Zoom, but most of you have been genetically tested when you're a baby, don't even know it. Your parents probably don't even remember it. And that's to find rare conditions that if they're detected in the first week of life and intervened upon medically, you can make them go away in some cases. And so in the state of Maryland, I think you're tested for more than 50 disorders. I'm not sure what the highs and the lows are. There are a couple of states that are higher and a couple of states that are lower. All 50 states test all newborn for a bunch of conditions. That program has been going on. It's done for less than $100 a sample, which is pretty amazing. It's mostly not DNA based, because if you have an enzyme deficiency, you could sequence the whole gene and find all these variants, some of which you won't be able to interpret, or you could just look to see functionally whether the metabolic product that enzyme is either missing or too much. And so most of them are that based. That's a roaring success, out of sight, out of mind. State labs do an amazing job. We've worked with the state lab in New York. They get 1,000 samples a day. For those of you who worked in the lab, imagining having the mailman deliver 1,000 samples a day, every single day, and you have 4 days to get those results back to those families. It's just very humbling to watch that. We did a large study of 5,000 people. It was complicated, took a year. Didn't have to get it back in 4 days. I mentioned Mendelian and rare diseases are have been a roaring success. When I first started in this field, we knew the molecular basis for maybe 60, 70 disorders that women deal in. There's now, and I don't know if anyone knows the total number right now, but it's in the hundreds and hundreds. There's still some that are elusive, but we've gotten most of them nailed because the tools work very well within families. And here's where DNA sequencing is a real boon as well. You may have heard about the use of rapid DNA sequencing when newborns end up in the intensive care unit. And that has been a program that we started funding a long time ago, now been used in, and being translated to real hospitals. It meets all of those conditions in that it helps do diagnosis, in some cases intervention, and it saves money. So that's another one. Inherited cancer syndromes, a small number of inherited cancer syndromes, mostly colon and breast and ovarian. The screening for that pre-symptomatically hits all those tier one markers in that you can intervene. We'd love to have an intervention that's better than surgical removal of breast and ovaries. I don't consider that prevention. And I don't consider screening prevention either. We don't have prevention, but we have a way to either detect or eliminate the risk of disease. Not great ones, we need to do better than that. I would say practices in transition. You will hear a bit about undiagnosed disease. This is a program that was pioneered in our own institute and then later expanded at the NIH. It's when everyone is baffled. We throw lots of tools, lots of expertise in genomics, and sometimes we can actually diagnose a disease that was undiagnosed and intervene and have it help. The problem with this is it struggles to translate all over the place. And so we're the country and other countries are trying to figure out how best to deal with this in the health system level. Because remember, translation doesn't happen until it's been used everywhere. Molecular diagnostics, I put as in transition, some are perfect. Some need a lot of work, and this is some of this is somatic by looking at tumors, looking at changes in tumors. It would be a mistake to say we can use every gene to molecular diagnose a condition, but we're getting there. Tumor genome analysis is something that is being done hundreds of thousands of times a year by the commercial sector. And academic labs. And this is when you look at the tumor to see if it has a handful of mutations that you might have a drug to match a drug with. Sometimes it works spectacularly and it's very important for the individual, but we're still struggling about how to do it and how to get hits in more and more cancers. So lots of cancers are negative. One of the unfortunate things about cancer is that you then find a treatment that works and then the tumor figures out how to get around the treatment. One of the most devilish is that there's a treatment based on understanding what the BRCA1 and 2 genes do that kills cells that don't have the gene, which is what the mutation is. And then some of the cells reactivate the gene to get around the chemotherapy. No one ever would have predicted, I think, that that was going to happen. So it's still a work in progress. Pharmacogenetics, which is matching the drug to the genotype of the person, so-called right drug at the right time to the right person. There are some absolute successes where it is life-saving. For some gene drug combinations, there are more pharmacogenetic interactions yet that we still don't know if it makes sense to do widespread screening. So it's there's 22,000 genes. We have to figure out more and more of them as we go. I think the promising but not yet ready is epigenetic gene manipulation. That's being able to turn genes on and off at will by messing with the epigenetic environment of the gene. There are some great successes in the basic science realm, but doing it in a real intact person is still problematic. Disease prevention is more of a translation problem than a basic science problem. A lot of diseases are based on one of the hardest things to change, which is our habits. And so there is a lot of research being done as to whether or not personalizing prevention messages by using a person's genome. It's helpful. I did a study with a behavioral scientist a long time ago that had some hint that might work, but we still don't know. And for anyone who's tried to break a bad habit, it is really, really tough. And that's a behavioral science question, not necessarily a genomics question. Exciting parts. Some of you are writing right now. What we do is we write, we read, and then we edit. and we edit some more and edit some more. It's DNA is information. It doesn't exactly work this way, but we now can read, edit, and write. And so this is the realm of sequencing, which we're really good at now, amazingly good at. If you had transported me back to me 25 years ago, I'd say, nah, we can't do that. The stuff we can do now, I would have said, no way, not in my lifetime. Editing, most of you have heard about CRISPR, is really becoming more and more powerful as people are finding new ways to do it. And synthetic DNA is becoming more and more successful. Back in the day, we used to have to pay, if we wanted 17 bases of synthetic DNA, it was $130 for 17 bases. So you very sparingly ordered those in the lab. Now it's a few dollars, and people are being able to synthesize whole chromosomes in the laboratory. Whole, small chromosomes, not hard chromosomes yet. So there's a tremendous amount of promise in the Steve Jobs way mentioning of integrating the technology and the biology in here. Computational biology is just pretty amazing. This is a computer probably 1/10 as powerful as, maybe even 1/1000th as powerful as a cell phone in 1946. And you now know we have server farms that do amazing computational stuff. And that has made some of the things that you hear about, machine learning, artificial intelligence, none of the science on those is new. Artificial intelligence and machine learning science, I actually had a good friend in college who was working on expert systems as a computer science major back at when you saw those pictures at the beginning of the talk. You couldn't do the computational. The computational power wasn't there. Now the power is to take those algorithms that were written 50, 60 years ago and bring them to the fore. And the really cool thing is that genetics and genomics produces a ton of data. And that's what these algorithms need. There are other disciplines that don't. And so I would tell anyone that you need to at least be somewhat savvy about what can be done in computational. I can't write code. I've tried a couple of times, it's too late for me. I'm not saying you have to write code, but you have to know when you can use these data sets and how to use them. I mentioned it earlier that I think gene therapy is coming through a revival. Up until recently, the gene therapy trials had killed more patients from side effects and bad events than had helped. And I think we're starting to turn that around. There were several setbacks over my lifetime, but I think that's starting to turn around. Understanding how to get the gene, the engineered thing into the right place is still a major challenge. Cells don't like taking up stuff. And if you have to do it specifically, that's still a problem. And then I think this is pretty close to the last slide. Filling out this equation is very important, and we need to get better at it. I don't think there's anyone in this room or on Zoom who thinks that an identical twin, one of whom grew up here and one who grew up here, would have the same outcomes in almost any measured parameter. And we know that. We've been neglecting it as geneticists because said that's somebody else's stuff. Epidemiologists can do it. I've been working with epidemiologists for now 25 years, and getting together is really powerful. And so working on gene-environment interactions, including social determinants of health, is really a big, important next phase. And you're going to hear some of that in some subsequent talks. I would just editorialize, I don't like talking about genetic determinants of health. I'm not going to be so bold to say that social scientists should stop saying social determinants as opposed to social factors. But they have the same problem. Social determinants of health are not as deterministic as we would like to present them. So we just have to be able to, I'm not gonna change the lingo, but we don't talk about genetic determinants of health anymore. We talk about genetic factors. That's where I'm gonna end. This is where I started the talk. I don't know if you can see that in the room or on Zoom. Those are pea plants. I think they're short pea plants. And that's outside of a monastery that I visited a couple of years ago, where this guy did all his work. And if you're ever in Brno in the Czech Republic, they have a great museum there. And you can sit and walk around the grounds where Mendel planted his plants. You should also know, they talk about Mendel tried a zillion plants before he got anything that had traits that we now call Mendelian. Going back to that original premise is that most traits aren't Mendelian. And they have his notebooks, he had really good handwriting, which is pretty amazing because I can read, I have terrible handwriting. No one could read my notes, but so that's where I'm gonna end. We're gonna go to question and answer round two. We've got 10 minutes or so for question and answers. I wanna thank everyone for attending. And just your take home is that genetics is not just yellow and green peas. I know that was a lot, but feel free to shoot questions.
We have a question from Gustavo online. Go ahead and unmute and turn on your camera if you'd like.
Hi, thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Lorien. So I want to try to express my appreciation for your talk and commend you because of your transparency and vulnerability in sharing your journey toward the career that you successfully got in genetics. It's really, really, really nice just to hear that. And could you elaborate on whether the microenvironment within cancer tumors allow for cells changes that led to outcomes you described before in the first part? And additionally, how do these tests for different types of cancer helps taking informed decisions to whether what process or treatment to take? And again, I just want to close up in thanking all for your talk and the HAG as well as NHGRI for this excellent series. Thanks.
Cool. Thank you. I hope you join the rest of the series. So the question about microenvironment, it's not an area I work in. The literature on this is tumor microenvironment is critically important. In fact, we probably all have tumors where the microenvironment is not suitable and they are surveilled and taken out. As I understand it, the surrounding cells can be a major factor, and there's several people who work in this field. As we do genetics, we're somewhat reductionist, and we tend not to study those. We just study what's in the tumor. In fact, one of the big advances in understanding tumors was to cut away everything except the tumor, and then being able to study, now we can do it at the single cell level, to study the tumor cells in isolation. That's probably a mistake. Remember, I talked about the holistic view when I did physiology. And I think it varies a lot from tumor to tumor. It's not an area where I have enough information to tell you which are the most important. I've been in meetings where I was like, wow, we need to think about this when people present that. It's like the immune system. It's another thing I still can't wrap my head around, but it's very important in the tumor world as well. Second question was the sequencing of the tumors. I think the issue is that we do a bad job of treating cancer overall. We have some spectacular results in especially juvenile cancers, where the number of kids that are cured is actually very, very high now, percentage-wise. Other cancers, we do a miserable job, in part because we detect them late. The thing that gives some people hope is this sequencing, because there are some tumors that have what's known in the field as driver mutations that are susceptible to specific drugs. And I'm sure everyone knows someone who's had to go through cancer treatment, and it is terrible. So anything that could be more precise, more specific, has a lot of excitement surrounding it. And so in some cases, in some of the skin cancers, some of the colon cancers, there are a subset of tumors that have this signature that says, this is the drug I'm going to pull off the shelf and use. And you get those spectacular results sometimes. I took them out. I had essentially MRIs of tumors that just dissolved in breast cancer and ovarian cancer based on a drug that was developed because of understanding BRCA1. The problem is that, one, not everyone has those signatures. So that's a bit of a sad part. And then the recurrence rate tends to be higher than we would like. So those victories that you see in some kids who are essentially cancer-free for the rest of their life are harder to come by. And it would also be a mistake to lump all the cancers together, because there's such a variety of phenotypes. And sometimes surgical cure really is surgical cure. So it's not a satisfactory answer. One of the things that I was in charge of the companies, I would love to have them collect more outcomes data. There are several large companies that are sequencing lots and lots of tumors because the oncologist want to try it. And if you get, even if it's one in 50 patients that has a significant regression and is cancer-free for another 3 years, that's a victory. But I don't know how much of those data are actually being collected. NIH, the NCI, has run a large trial called MATCH, where they try to enroll lots of people to have their tumor sequenced and then do the drug and then match them, regardless of tumor type, to the drugs that might intervene. And they found fewer matches than I think they would like. Still, if you're facing possibility of dying of your tumor or you do want to do one more thing, you might want to try it. Fortunately, some but not all of the drugs have a less vicious side effect profile because they're targeting a molecular lesion as opposed to just targeting cells that grow fast.
Thank you so much.
I kind of have a follow-up question to that, and it's just a clarifying question. When discussing the microbiome around a tumor, would that be considered spatial biology, like a category of it?
So not microbiome, but microenvironment, which is microbiome, which is the bugs that live inside us,
right,
is not as well explored, and it's probably relevant mostly to colon cancer, which is, if you think about it, your colon is outside of your body. Topologically, it's outside of your body. You tend not to think about it, but it is. And so the microbiome might have a strong influence on there. And there are data that metabolites from those bugs that live in your gut could promote or inhibit colon cancer. But tumor microenvironment is the cells that are non-cancer cells that get recruited and support the cancer. And spatial biology, which I didn't put in here, but is another incredibly explosive field. And those techniques would really work for looking at the tumor microenvironment, as long as you don't trim away all that stuff when you're looking at the tumor. I didn't talk about single cell. It's just amazing. You can sequence the genome in a single cell, sequence all the transcripts in a single cell. There's even proteomic methods to look at a single cell and then reassemble them back into position. It's an amazing field that has exploded only in the last 10 years. But yes, it's going to be an active area of research.
We have another anonymous question online. Do you envision genetics also incorporating non-reductionist approaches sometime in the future as a field? And if so, how might that pan out?
So then there's a difference between holistic without measuring things and non-reductionist when you're measuring lots of things. So I have a harder time as someone who generates data to figure out how to do the holistic, like take care of the person's soul and take care of their whole environment. I don't know if that's can certainly be impactful psychologically, whether that can make the tumor go away or make the blood pressure go away. Probably blood pressure might be amenable to that. But holistic in that we're now measuring not just the DNA, but the RNA, the proteome, the social determinants, the social environment, all of these things we can put in, especially with the new computational methods, can be put into models if we have enough data. So it's not holistic, but I don't know if you would say ChatGPT answering my essay questions is holistic or not. It's taking into the entirety of everything written that it's been able to absorb. So I think those kind of things are more possible. I couldn't comment on holistic view of treating the person. It's just not my field.
Well, I think we will pause there. So let's thank Dr. Brody again, and we will stop our recording.
Thank you.